and she's also interested in conducting awareness programs to the community. Ma'am has an experience of 10 years in the field of pediatric nephrology and has published 14 publications in PubMed, Scopus, Index journals. We welcome you, ma'am.
A very good morning to all. It's a great privilege to be here. I thank the organizing team for this wonderful opportunity to talk on urinary tract infection in children. So we're going to discuss about the current guidelines on evaluation of pediatric urinary tract infection in children. What we see commonly in our day-to-day practices, I'll discuss three scenarios and then let's discuss the evaluation. Case one, this is a 5 years old girl child who brought with the history of fever for 5 days. She had pain during urination. There was no history of hematuria, cloudy urine, or passage of crystals, mud in the urine. She did not have any vomiting or loose stools. On examination, she was febrile. Hydration is good. There was no vulval synechiae on local examination. System examination was normal. Urine routine showed turbid in appearance. Plenty of pustules were there, pus clumps were there. She had 1 plus proteinuria. Urine culture was growing E. coli 10 to the power of 5. It was sensitive to the routine antibiotics, cefixime, amikacin, Oflox, and so on. The total count was elevated with the polypredominant. CRP was elevated. Blood culture was sterile. So this is simple febrile urinary tract infection. Coming to the next scenario, this is a 3-year-old boy who had high-grade fever for 4 days with the chills and rigors. He also had vomiting and cried during urination. On examination, he was febrile, looking toxic and dehydrated. Right loin tenderness was there. Total count was elevated. CRP was high. He is also having mild elevation of blood urea nitrogen and creatinine is on the higher side. Urine routine showed plenty of pus cells with the 2 plus protein. Culture is growing E. coli, significant growth. So this is a child who's looking toxic, dehydrated with the right loin tenderness with the elevated counts and slightly altered renal functions also. Imaging is showing right rhinomegaly with the pelvic wall thickening. So this is right acute pyelonephritis picture. So now we call this as complicated urinary tract infection. Coming to the third scenario, this is a 6-year-old girl child who presented with a fever for 5 days, pain during urination. There was history of febrile urinary tract infection thrice in the past. She was evaluated for the same and found to have grade 4 vesicoureteric reflux bilaterally. On probing, she is also having the history of infrequent voiding, less than 3 times a day. Day and nighttime wetting is there. History of standing while passing urine and stools is there. Constipation, chronic constipation history is also there. On examination, child is febrile, but hydration is adequate. Urinary bladder is palpable on examination. She is also having loaded sigmoid. Urine routine showed pyuria and urine culture is growing E. coli. Ultrasound is showing bilateral rhinomegaly with the urinary bladder wall thickening and significant post-void residue of 30 ml. This is recurrent urinary tract infection in a child who is having bowel bladder dysfunction. Second episode of UTI is called recurrent urinary tract infection. And bowel bladder dysfunction, usually we diagnose in children who are more than 5 years of age with a recurrent UTI. The histories like infrequent voiding, standing while passing urine and stools, postponing voiding, constipation are favoring this BBD. So usually urinary tract infection is identified by the presence of symptoms with a significant growth of a single species of a bacteria in urine culture. 3 to 7% girls and 1 to 2% boys experience an episode of UTI before the age of 6 years. E. coli is the most common bacterial cause of UTI. And other gram-negative bacterial pathogens include Klebsiella, Proteus, Enterobacter, and Citrobacter. Rarely, gram-positive bacterial pathogens like Staph, Saprobiticus, Enterococcus, Staph aureus also can be the cause. Viral UTI is usually limited to lower urinary tract and uncommon in children. Like fungal UTI also very less common, but it can happen in children who are under immunosuppression, long-term use of broad-spectrum antibiotic therapy, and indwelling urinary catheter. Nowadays, what we commonly see in our clinical practice is urinary tract infection caused by organisms producing ESBL. So they have inherent resistance to the usual antibiotics such as penicillin and cephalosporin. Papers had shown that the prevalence ranged from 1% to 11%. What are the known risk factors for ESBL UTI? Children who are having renal anomaly, recent hospitalization, instrumentation, recurrent urinary tract infection, and use of inappropriate antibiotics. Renal anomaly in the sense that pelvic urethral junction obstruction, posterior urethral valve, neurogenic bladder, vesicoureteric reflex, etc. So we have certain protective factors in our body to prevent urinary tract infection. They are unobstructed urinary transport from the kidney to the bladder, unidirectional urine flow, operative antimicrobial urothelial activity, regular and complete bladder emptying, normal perineal resistance. Certain potential factor promoting the urinary infection include renal stone disease, intrarenal reflux in case of compound papillae or reflux due to acquired causes, obstructive uropathy either at the PUJ level or PUV, or stones causing obstruction, defective urothelial defense, imbalance voiding, neurogenic bladder, or sometimes acquired dysfunctional voiding, periurethral colonization, soilage, inflammation, etc. How can they present? This has varied clinical presentation in various age groups. Neonates can present with a sepsis with poor feeding, vomiting, jaundice, temperature instability, fever without any focus. Whereas older children and children who are presenting with uncomplicated lower urinary tract infection will present with a low-grade fever, dysuria, frequency, urgency, hematuria, and foul-smelling urine. Complicated UTI or upper urinary tract infection or acute pyelonephritis is usually characterized by high-grade fever with chills and rigors, persistent vomiting, loin pain, and dehydration. Apart from this routine clinical manifestation, they can also present with a recurrent fever without any focus, diarrhea, abdominal pain, failure to gain weight, may be the presentation in toddlers. Urinary incontinence, straining during urination, poor urinary stream, anorectal malformation, and spinal abnormalities can be seen in children who are having underlying structural abnormalities. So always give importance for growth parameters, blood pressure, and systemic toxicity signs. In a urinary tract infection, if you're suspecting, always look for palpable distended bladder, enlarged kidneys, suprapubic and renal angle tenderness, palpable fecal mass in the colon in case of suspected BBD, vulval synechiae in a girl child and phimosis in a male child should be addressed, and it should completed with a spinal examination. So coming to the screening test for urinary tract infection, we have few. Microscopic examination to look for pyuria, and we also have dipstick tests like leukocyte esterase test and nitrate reduction test. When you combine these tests with a microscopy, the sensitivity is increasing to 99.8 and specificity to 70%. This is another mode is enhanced urine analysis, where you will add this pyuria with the gram staining. This is having highest specificity of 99.9% and sensitivity of 85%. So you can use these screening tests before getting the urine culture and start the child on empirical antibiotic therapy. So urine culture is the gold standard investigation of choice to diagnose urinary tract infection. In neonates and infants, urine sample is usually obtained by either suprapubic aspiration or transurethral bladder catheterization. In a toilet-trained child, you can advise them to take this midstream sample. The recent guidelines, Indian Society of Pediatric Nephrology 2021, they have changed this colony count alone slightly. As per this, even a single pathogen growth is significant when you do the culture by suprapubic aspiration. When you do the culture by urethral catheterization and in children who are symptomatic, you can take 10,000 colony forming count as significant. Midstream clean catch, there is no change. You have to have more than a lakh colony count to say that it is urinary tract infection. So what are the practical difficulties as a pediatrician we are facing when we advise them to take the urine culture? You have to give them a written simple and clear instructions to the patient for the collection of urine. They have to wash the hands and the urethral meatus, collect the sample after spreading the vulvar labia or withdrawing the foreskin of the glands in male child. Midstream collection is mainly to reduce the contamination from the urethral and vaginal cells, and secretions can be avoided. Transport the urine sample to lab within 2 to 3 hours, or if it is not possible, store it in 2 to 8 degrees for a day. We can get false positive results in case of contamination from genital secretion or bacterial overgrowth upon standing. False negative results also we can get if it is misinterpreted bacteria or lysis of the leukocytes, or it is also favored by alkaline pH or low specific gravity or delayed urine sediment examination. Another thing is, even a single dose of antibiotics can make the culture sterile. In that case, we take that as culture negative urinary tract infection, though we don't have that ICD code for that. What is the role of ultrasound imaging in urinary tract infection? This is the primary imaging we do for children with urinary tract infection. We can find out if upper tract is involved, unilateral or bilateral, involvement is focal or diffuse. Acute pyelonephritis is characterized by renomegaly, enlarged kidney. You can find out compression of the calluses and renal calluses. Corticomedullary differentiation may be altered. You can have echogenic renal parenchyma. Pelvic wall thickening is a sign of pyelitis. Whenever the child is having bladder wall thickening and significant post-void residue, suspect voiding dysfunction. Rarely in children, emphysematous pyelonephritis, you can find air in the renal parenchyma. And the next imaging is voiding cystourethrogram. This is the gold standard investigation of choice to find out the bladder anomaly like posterior urethral valve and vesicoureteric reflex. This is the reflex. Then after doing the VCUG, we grade the reflex from stage 1 to stage 5. And the first picture is showing the bilateral vesicoureteric reflex grade 2. On the next middle picture is vesicoureteric reflex grade 4 to 5. The last picture is showing posterior urethral valve with the bladder diverticulum. Though PUV children present with the poor urinary stream, many times we find out PUV following urinary tract infection evaluation. What is the role of DMSA in urinary tract infection? The earlier guidelines had said that it can be done in the acute phase or in the chronic phase. The guidelines have changed now in 2021. There is no role for DMSA in the acute phase. Earlier, we used to do. In the acute phase, if it is done, the acute pyelonephritis will be shown as photopenic areas. Left kidney is showing the photopenic area and the right side is normal. So what is the recent guidelines about role of various imaging in febrile urinary tract infection? When you have a child with the first episode of urinary tract infection, go for ultrasound. If it is normal, you can just leave it in children more than 3 years of age. But if the child is having any abnormal finding in ultrasonogram, 2 to 3 weeks later, you have to go for MCU scan. And if it is high grade VUR, then do DMSA. There are 5 grades, 1 to 5. 3, 4, 5 is called high grade vesicoureteric reflex. And another category is children who are less than 3 years, atypical urinary tract infection, septicemia, poor urinary flow, abdominal mass, poor or no response to routine antibiotics within 48 hours, raised creatinine, non-E. coli infection, then you have to go for ultrasound and other imagings. Another category is recurrent urinary tract infection, which is second episode of urinary tract infection. They have to undergo all the imaging irrespective of the age. Coming to the treatment, children who are more than 3 months of age, tolerating orally, hydration status is adequate, you need not hospitalize the child, go for oral antibiotics. The commonly used antibiotic is cefixime, coamoxiclav, ciprofloxacin, ofloxacin or cefalexin. When you prefer hospitalization, parenteral antibiotics, ceftriaxone, cefotaxime, amikacin, gentamicin, coamoxiclav can be given. But make sure that the renal function is normal before giving aminoglycosides. And serial monitoring of renal function also should be done when we start the child on aminoglycosides. So what are we going to do when we get this ESBL producing organisms? According to the up-to-date guidelines, they have given only the carbapenem agents for the treatment of VSBL UTI. Either meropenem, aripiprazole, or imipenem can be used. But still, in our practice, we use carbapenem sparing agents in non-severe ESBL infection. We are using it because in the sensitivity pattern, they are giving that, and children are also responding to this treatment. So in case of ESBL organism, we can start with the piperazolin tazobactam, 200 to 300 milligram per kg per day in 3 to 4 divided doses. So the duration of treatment is 7 to 10 days for complicated urinary tract infection, 3 to 5 days for cystitis. But whenever you're suspecting some acute lobar nephronia, the duration increases to 2 to 3 weeks. And if it is abscess, then you may have to go for further screening like CT abdomen, and if needed, drainage should be done. A word about the bladder bowel dysfunction. It is an abnormal pattern of micturition in the presence of intact neuronal pathways without congenital or anatomical abnormalities. This abnormality either be in the filling phase, that is overactive bladder, they will be having frequent urination, or in the evacuation phase, dysfunctional voiding. The bladder and sphincter dyssynergia. It is characterized by thickened urinary bladder wall. You can measure the thickness in the ultrasound. Significant post-void residue of more than 20 ml. Persistent high-grade vesico-ureteric reflex and spinning top configuration of the bladder on MCU. So they can have the history of constipation, maneuvers to postpone voiding, and voiding less than 3 times or more than 8 times per day. Always suspect bowel bladder dysfunction. The last image is showing the Vincent's Kersey. They will cross the legs, pinch the genitalia to postpone voiding. How are we going to manage them? Adequate fluid intake should be advised with a balanced diet with whole grains, fruits, and vegetables. You have to give importance for this regular bowels. Treatment of irregular bowels with stool softener can be initiated with a PEC, mineral oil, lactulose, lactitol, magnesium hydroxide, sorbitol, and senna. Insist them on timed voiding, double voiding, and squat to void. This double voiding is mainly to avoid the post-void residue. This will also help in children who are having high-grade reflux. What is the role of antibiotic prophylaxis in VUR? The recent meta-analysis by Hari et al. Is showing that only in high-grade VUR, this can be marginally beneficial. So as a routine, we don't give antibiotic prophylaxis for children who are having low-grade reflux. So whenever a child is having primary VUR, divide them, low-grade VUR or high-grade VUR. For children who are having low-grade VUR, antibiotic is needed only if they have bowel bladder dysfunction. In children who are having high-grade VUR, antibiotic prophylaxis can be given up to 2 years of age or 1 year from the last episode of urinary tract infection. But if they are having BBD, antibiotic prophylaxis should be continued. Whenever the child is having recurrent UTI, but there is no bowel bladder dysfunction, you can always opt them for ureteric reimplantation or endoscopic injection. So for the time constraint, I'll skip that myths and facts. So other therapeutic intervention, routinely circumcision in case of male children, cranberry juice or probiotics are not recommended. But only in children who are having normal urinary tract and recurrent UTI, cranberry may be useful. This is the recent evidence. A word about asymptomatic bacteria. It is a benign condition. It does not cause renal injury and requires no treatment. The organism is usually E. coli. So eradication often follows symptomatic infection with a virulent strain. So we don't treat this. The presence of asymptomatic bacteria in a child with previously treated UTI should not be considered as recurrent UTI. What is the referral criteria to a pediatric nephrologist? Whenever a child is having recurrent UTI with a BBD, high-grade VUR, urologic or renal abnormalities, children who are having renal scars, deranged renal function, hypertension should be followed up with a pediatric nephrologist. So the take-home points would include rapid dipstick-based tests are useful in screening for UTI. The culture and sensitivity is, however, the gold standard for diagnosing urinary tract infection. Urine collection needs to be appropriate for correct interpretation. Always give importance for bowel bladder dysfunction whenever a child is having recurrent urinary tract infection. Radio imaging is required to rule out underlying abnormality in a stepwise manner and less aggressive manner. So we need not go for all DMSA, MCU at one point. Children with a recurrent UTA, BBD and VUR need regular follow-up. Renal dysplasia is the culprit for end-stage renal disease, not the vesico-ureteric reflex. Initially, we thought that the VUR is causing all the problems like progression of CKD going for end-stage renal disease. That whatever be the grade of VUR, the hypoplastic component is the cause for progression of CKD. So you need not worry about that. Only the high grade VUR needs antibiotic prophylaxis. Thank you.
Thank you, madam, for the excellent speech, and you've cleared all our doubts, and the different types of urinary tract infections have been explained in detail. Thank you, madam. Any doubts from the audience?
Yes, sir. There are many studies in pediatric age group, but they have finally advised that this can be used as a prophylactic measure.